And the next module which we have, it's about your introducing indexes. That what are indexes and why we generally use indexes, what is the significance of using of indexes as well, is what we will be going to cover now.
Mm-hmm.
At this point, when I will take you to the indexes, so the basic objectives, first of all, we are going to discuss about that what are the core indexing concepts, what are the data types and indexes, what are heaps, clusters and non-cluster indexes, single column and composite indexes. These all are my objectives which we are going to discuss. In the first part, we are first going to check for the how SQL Server accesses the data, then the need for indexes, then what is the structure of an index, what is the selectivity, density and index depth, and what do you mean by index fragmentation. Then we'll see a index fragmentation. We'll also try to give you the solution that how to resolve it. Okay.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
So initially, when you are going to work with your SQL Server, so how initially your SQL Server this data, right? Please understand, SQL Server initially accesses the data by using indexes or by scanning all the data pages in a table. One quick concept I'm talking about, right? If mm-hmm. I am not providing the index, so now it actually needs to, or it is actually going to make sure that it will read each and every page, and then only you will be able to read the data. So what I mean to say here is that suppose, just a minute, let me pull out my whiteboard. Okay, if you will go to this part, and you just need to understand one thing here. So how the data is stored in our table, they are stored in a form of or inside the pages, correct or not?
Correct.
So now at this point, suppose I do have a simple database table with me, where I have some small pages. So I do have the pages. Where we are storing the data. Now, if I want to search for some data, how the search part is going to be work over here? For searching that data, first of all, if I am not using indexes, so suppose I want to search for the details of year 2014, suppose, right?
Mm-hmm.
For year 2014, to scan that data, I need to go on each and every page. So I need to search this page, then this, then this, then this, then this, and suppose my data resides somewhere here. That's my data where it is resides.
Mm-hmm.
Now the place where my data resides, after scanning lots of pages, this 2014 data will be captured, and then this data is going to be provided to the user, right?
Mm-hmm.
But I want to use it other way around. Now please understand, every particular page that you can see there, they have a page number. They actually have a page number, and we can also call them pointer value. They are the pointer values actually. Every particular page where your data has been stored, they have their own identity. They have their own ID. Now, another way of searching the same data is that I can use it like this. I will remove first of all this whole stuff from here. The same content is provided, but this time when I'm providing my content at this place, I can maybe providing like, first I'm going to mention my first table. Then I will go for the second page, but I'm using some ID which may be there. I'm using some ID for them. So now how many pages we have? We have 8 pages here. So now every page have an ID. What I will do is I will create an index. Now, whenever you will create an index is a combination of two things. One is your key and then value.
Primary key or any key?
No. Just a key. Key means address key or pointer key. Address.
Okay.
So key and value. In the key, what we have? In the key, we do have the page numbers, you can say that, like 201, 202, mm-hmm. and the value which you are actually searching for, something like that. Okay. Or just keep it like this. So now something like that. So initially what happened, when you are going to work with your, or whenever you will use your indexes here, so in the case of indexes, you have a key and a value. This value is always be the value which you are want to search for. And this will be the page number. Actually, indexes itself have the index pages where all these information have been stored. Whenever you create an index, index actually create their own custom page. And in that page, they have this key value stored inside it. Getting my point?
Can you please explain again about this index thing?
Initially, what happened when you will go for an indexes approach, initially we do have this key value. So whenever you create an index have an index page. An index always create their own index page. And an index page, whatever column or whatever table you are going to mention and whatever column on which you are going to mention, they are going to be stored. So it means apart from working with an individual page, I'm going to use from the index page. So now when I'm going to read the data, I'm actually going to read the data. Not only I'm going to read the data from this page, but not scanning each and every page individually. Right? I have already created an index. An index have a key value. So this is suppose 201, 202, 203, something like that. Now in page 202, I have E004 ID. So here, suppose I do have an entry for E004. So whenever I will give a request for searching the data, because of the index, it will directly go to 202.
Mm-hmm.
And then it will read the corresponding data inside that. Still, you have some confusion. I can understand that.
Yes, let's see. Maybe, I will understand it on examples and
Okay. So, to understand that part, let's go with this. So actually we have two ways to go with. One will be the table scan, right? One will be the index scan. So generally, sometimes SQL Server or like the fact is there that creating an index is not required. However, accessing data is usually considerably slow without indexes. When you are not using an indexes there, it is deliberately slow. So you need to understand one thing, that SQL Server sometimes makes its own temporary indexes to improve the query performances. So at this time, when I will go for the clustered and non-cluster indexes, kind of options are there. We call them cluster indexes and non-cluster indexes. So now to understand this, first of all, why we need an index? Let's understand them gradually. Okay. Mm-hmm. Why we need an index? So to understand the index, ANSI SQL does not mention indexes, generally considered to be external to the logical data model. So whatever queries that you are going to execute without indexes, performance will be improved by the presence of indexes. So now what is the condition here? Let me just explain you one more time. And this time Let's see. I hope that you will not, I will not miss any specific part as well. Well, so at this time, suppose I have a table. Now this time, let's go into the more bigger option that we will be going to work with. So I have a table. And how the data store inside my table? Inside the pages. Now you need to understand one thing, that in our table, every particular page have a page ID or a page number, whatever you can call it. So suppose I have 8 different columns. Now this is a table like employee table. This is an employee table. And here the columns, I'm just using 2 columns here or 3 columns, like EID, employee ID, ename, and EH. These are the 3 records which have been stored inside that. Okay, till now is okay.
Yes.
Now please understand, every page when you will generally use it, they have a page number. They have a page ID. Page ID means, suppose the page ID for this will be 201. This may be 202. This may be 203. 204. 205, 206, 7, and 8, and all these pages are containing some values, and these values are combination of employee ID. They have employee name and employee age. Till now is everything fine?
Yes.
Now I want to search the data. I want to search the data. Right now, no index is created. Now, when I will give a search request and I want to search for, say, employee ID E025, employee 25. Now, employee 25 may be stored somewhere here. Okay.
Mm-hmm.
Now it is fine.
Yes.
Now, when the search request have been started from there, what it will do? It will initially go to page 1, look for the data, page 2, look for the data, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, and then it will scanning to the 8th page, and then from the 8th page, they have accessed this E025. Now, what is the problem that you may have seen here? That I need to go with each and every page to read the data, right? So it's just like a book of 50 pages, or maybe let's keep it to 50 pages. And that book doesn't have any indexes. And I want you to search for a value, an information about, say, word alpha, or maybe the alpha. Now, what you will do, you will scan every particular 50 pages.
Okay, can I ask you something?
Yeah.
So, for example, in my understanding, when you say we do this search, like I want to do this search in the employee table. So I write select all from employee, mm-hmm. where employee ID E025. Mm-hmm. What is the problem to find this, you know, row according to this E025?
The problem is that, and that to be without indexes, I'm talking about, right? You don't have any indexes.
Yes.
You need to scan every page. Every page. 8 pages are there. Maybe this E025 may be stored on some. So you need to scan every page. Page 1, page 2, page 3, page 4. Actually, you are traveling. See, suppose your data is on 208 page number. Okay.
So you are saying that all pages should be indexed and my search will work in this case because it's indexed.
So yeah, that's what I'm just discussing about that. First, take scenario one. In the first scenario, I don't have indexes. Okay.
Mm-hmm. And you will not find, you will not be able to, if you don't have the index, you will not be able to find that employee like that with that select statement. No?
No. I'm not saying that. The thing is that here, if I want to search for employee ID 25, so ma'am, what I have to do is it will be stored in 208. I don't have indexes. I don't know the page number. I need to scan with every page. So this will look for this E25 first in page one. It will not find it. Then go to page two, then page three, page four, page five, six, seven. And in the eighth page, they actually get the employee ID 25. Got it? So what it does, it scan every particular page which is there. The query will run. I am not saying that the query will not run. Query will run and you will get the data, but it will take time. Okay, so now, when you have run this search statement for employee ID 25, you are actually going to scan or search for search in every page. First, you will search in page number 201, then 202, then 203, 4, 5, 6, and 7. I don't have any indexes there. It will impact the performance. Why? Because it's just like that you are scanning each and every folder that I do have. But if I know a specific folder, where my data or where my software may be installed. So don't you think it's easy for me to get it more quickly?
Yes.
To search that information more quickly. In that case, what I can do is, right now, this is the problem, performance issues. So it means initially, suppose it takes around 1 minute to look for the data. 1 minute is a big time.
Yeah, so my search will be faster. If I have a huge database and my pages are indexed, they will be just, you know, working faster.
Right. I have only 50 pages, but now I have, suppose, 500 pages. So now you can easily understand the impact on the searching part. But if I will prepare or if I will create an index right here. So this time I am using an index. Now, what index will do? Index will store all these pages ID inside it, like a page number. So when we scan to a book, we generally go to that. We will just go via indexes. We'll check for the header, from header to the topic where it is, and then page number. Correct or not?
Yes.
Now your index is created. Now please run the search. When you run the search, because the page number is already there in the index, so index actually have their own index pages. Index have their own pages where the pointer address of each and every information is stored. You are not actually scanning everything. You only have this pointer address. As soon as the pointer address is there, the search will run. That search will go inside this data page, and because my page details are stored, so 208 was the page where E25 was there, and this has already been stored inside the index. So my index will not scan every page. It will directly go to 208, and then it is going to retrieve the data. And suppose this process takes 10 seconds. So which one is faster, the one with indexes or the one without indexes? Hello, am I audible?
Yes.
Okay, yeah. So the question here is that whenever I have the index pages where all the page numbers are stored, so when you will give a request, right, they are not scanning all the records. They will simply scan the numbers, the index pages, the page numbers. As soon as it will get the page number, it will directly go to that page, okay, and then they will read the data, and it takes 10 seconds to read that data.
I got
so
it
here I am saving almost 50 seconds of mine, correct or not?
Mm-hmm, correct.
And 50 seconds in the world of data is a big number.
I know.
So now, I hope now the structure is clear that what I was discussing.
Yes, thank you.
No problem. Same thing, these guys are following it. They have an author index and they have your title index. They have A, H, O, V, A, D, L, Q, and then they are storing the data. The need for indexes is there. So this is the index structure initially. Whenever you are going to work with a server, that initially the SQL server uses form of balanced tree. That is that you can see inside the slide, which describe a binary tree for simplicity. Now, at this point, if I want to search for the value from 1 to 100, between 1 to 100, I want to send the value. So I want to tell you one thing. Actually, whenever you are going to work with the index structures, their index are initially divided into two type of indexes. We have, initially, I have two type of indexes. And those two type of indexes are cluster index and non-cluster index. The difference between a cluster index and non-cluster index was, or is, that in case of a cluster index, we actually use the concept of sorting. Use the concept of sorting, and actually you do have multiple nodes which are there when you will work with the cluster index. The first node that we have here, we call them the root. The second node is like a location where I'm just storing. So root, this is known as your intermediate. And then they do have the third node, which is known as your data and leaf node. So this is connected like this. That's the structure we have. So now at this time, when I will take you to the slide, now see the structure here. I do have the data between 1 to 100, okay?
Mm-hmm.
I'm getting the data between 1 to 100. This is my root node. Root node means where the all pages basic information is stored. Then we call them the intermediate node. This is the intermediate node. It can be your intermediate node. In the intermediate node, you do have the distribution of the data. So suppose this one is page number one, this one is page number two, index page two, index page three, index page two have a range of 1 to 100, index page number three have a range of 101 to 200. This is known as your intermediate. This is the second node. We call them the intermediate node. Now, from this intermediate node, we will go to the, we call them the leaf node. This is the leaf node. In the leaf node, now I have this two consist of, again, further distribution. So suppose this is page number four, page number five, page number six, page number seven. And this is what we call the leaf node. Leaf node, and this one is my, or you can say it's a combination of this, and this is a combination of leaf node or data nodes as well. These are the leaf initially, mm-hmm. Right?
Got it.
So
got it.
Can be the combination of leaf nodes or data nodes initially when it is a non-cluster indexes. When a cluster index, when it is a non-cluster indexes. So leaf node will be separate, and data node will be separate.
It's a clustered or non-clustered, you said?
Right now, it is a combination of both. If I will go for a clustered, in case of your cluster, your leaf node and data node will be the same. If cluster, then leaf and data are same. If it is a non-cluster, if it is a non-cluster index, then leaf node will be defined separately and data node will be defined separately. Because the number of pages increased at this point of time. So right now, what is the depth which I'm using? I'm using a depth as 4. Depth as 4 means because I have level 1, level 2, level 3, and level 4. Right?
Right.
Now, if you have any doubt or any confusion from this part, first clear this up, then I will move to the next slide.
But will you show me, like, will we have on the demonstration the sample of the cluster and non-cluster? It's just, you know, I have never seen this, so I mean, I got the idea of what it is, but I don't know. I need to see how it looks like.
No, that's okay. See, first of all, there is no as such any critical or your complex structure for it, right? The only thing is that when you will create it, it runs in the background.
Mm-hmm.
You cannot see the background procedure here, but yes, we are just giving you the detailed information about it. So look at this. Now, if you will see this slide here, right? In this slide, what I have used, I have just talked about this tree. This is actually not a binary tree. It's a balanced tree. We call them the balanced tree. Don't consider it. Or here, B tree does not stand for the binary key. It is for the balanced key. It's a balanced tree. In this case, you can see there that you are using a more balanced tree, and the same principle as a binary key is used to navigate the tree and find the desired values. The difference here is that SQL Server may have more than 2 leaves to a node, and this leads to the tree structure being very flat. And most database indexes are no more than 3 or 4 levels deep, right? And we will see a demo where we will just discuss about this part as well. Right, so this is B-tree. B-tree is not means binary tree, it's a balanced tree. And as you can see, they are maintaining the balance perfectly, correct?
Correct.
Equal distributions are there in the data. So we'll discuss about the demo as well, and I will show you that. So now at this time, there are 3 things that we need to focus on. We call them the selectivity, density, and index depth. What are these 3 terminologies which is all about? Now, when I will go for this terminology known as selectivity of the data or selectivity of the information that you are actually be using at this location. So at this time, while going with your selectivity means here, it's a measure of how many rows are returned compared to the total number of rows. Because suppose if you are using a where clause to read the data. Now, I already have the indexes created. The data is already stored inside the index pages, and as the data is stored inside the index pages, right, I can be able to fetch that data very, very, really, very quickly. Just 1 minute, Julia. Let me put blanket on my kids because they are not just now doing it from here.
All right.
So now, initially, when I will go with this approach for selectivity, density, and depth here, in the case of your selectivity, additional indexes on a table are most useful when they are highly selective. Where the selectivity is what? It's the most important consideration when you are selecting which column should be included in an indexes. Right? You need to decide that which column you would like to include inside the indexes. So it's a measure of how many rows are returned compared to the total number of rows. And high selectivity means a small number of rows when related to the total number of rows. So you have created maybe a you have used it with one column. Say column name is employee ID. Now employee ID is a primary key, and primary key consists of a clustered. We call them the cluster index. Cluster index already uses the pre-sorting option, and because of that, It is very much faster on comparison to a normal process or a normal index implementation which is there. So in the case of your selectivity, so suppose if you want to, just for an example, you want to locate some books by a specific author in a physical library, right, to read mm-hmm. that book.
Yes.
So you need to follow a few steps over there. First of all, you need to find the first entry for the author in the indexes. Then you will locate the index in the bookcases based on the information in the index entry as well. Then returning to the index and finding the next entry for the author and locate the book in the bookcases based on the information in that next index entry. So what you are doing is you are actually keep repeating these steps until you had found all of the books by that author, right? So generally, mm-hmm. it's a good example is the public library, libraries that we generally go there. In our library location also, you may be able to find out the same concept. Because in library, we have bookshelves. And they have mentioned that one department is for history, one department is for geography, one is for political science, one is for, say, philosophy, one is for psychology, right? So multiple departments are there, multiple locations and multiple bookshelves you will find out. And you want to go for a specific author only, right? You want to read the book mm-hmm. for a specific author. So how you will do? So in our real world, you will go to the library. You will request for that book, give your entries, whatever entry they required, you can provide that entry. Then you will go to that section where these books may be available. You will then scan the books together. And you are actually not scanning every particular shelf which is there. Where you go with, suppose you want to know about philosophy. For philosophy, you will go only to the philosophy section. Correct?
Mm-hmm. Yes.
Author is okay, whatever author you have. So you can just search the author book. Or if you will go to the grocery markets, they have different divisions. They have different divisions. Like they have a vegetable section is different. Fruit section is different. Correct? Right?
Correct.
So vegetable section mm-hmm. is different. Fruit section is different. Okay. These all are my different sections. Now, and all these different sections have different informations. And all these informations can be managed and allocated by the selectivity as well. Is it clear?
Clear.
The second thing is your density. Density is a measure of the lack of uniqueness of the data in the table. And high density indicates a large number of duplicates. So initially, density is a measure, or density is basically 1 divided by number of unique values in the column. Initially, a dense column is 1 that has a high number of duplicated values. So the index will perform at its best when it has a low level of density. So you need to make sure the density must be low. The density must be low. Right, and density is about the levels must be low, or the less the repetition is, the more frequently you are going to get the data. The more the repetition is, the more hard work, you can say that the more hard work is going to be performed by your, or the more hard work is going to be performed by your indexes there. So that's a concept of your index depth. Okay.
Okay.
Then we can have an index fragmentation. We have a concept of fragmentation, like the way we have the file fragmentation. So we also have this concept of your index fragmentation. Now, when I say index fragmentation, what does it mean? Index fragmentation means that your indexes are unorganized. They are unorganized, right? They mm-hmm. may be using, or they may be it's just about. So to understand it, let me go with one example which I would like to tell you about it. So how does fragmentation occurs? What it says, SQL Server reorganize index pages when data modification cause index pages to split. So initially, index fragmentation is the inefficient use of pages within an index. And fragmentation can occur over time as data in a table is modified. So suppose you are reading the data. Indexes perform best when each page of the index is as full as possible, but indexes may initially start full or relatively full modifications to the data in the indexes. So from the physical library analogy that I have just discussed with you, right? You can check for a library that has full bookcases. What occurs when a new book needs to be added?
Okay.
If the book is added to the end of the library, the process is easy. However, if you will put it in the middle, right, the new version of that book.
Right.
So now that's where the issue goes on. You need to readjust all the surrounding bookcases as well. Is it clear? The
clear.
Fragmentation issue?
Mm-hmm. Okay. Yes.
So now we have types of fragmentation. We call them the internal fragmentation, where the pages are not full. And external is like where pages are out of logical sequence. For example, let's take the same analogy of your bookcases only. So in the library, internal fragmentation is similar to what would occur if an existing bookcase was split into two big bookcases. Each bookcase would then be only half full if it is split, right? If you will add two more,
yes.
So half. So now it's like that in one bookshelf, 100 books will be there. Now what you did, you have divided those 100 bookshelf location into two sub shelf, but in that shelf, the information was same, 100 records only, but it is half. So now 50 books are okay, but now I have 50 empty values, correct?
Mm-hmm.
Or, so now if you will go with this part, and I will just explain you with that. If you have any issues, please let me know about it. So initially what happened, this was my bookshelf, and this bookshelf had a capacity of storing up to, say, 10 books. So 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10. And they all are already filled up. Now, what internal means? Internal fragmentation means? Internal means now you have divided this into two bookshelves. Well, despite of both the bookshelf have the same capacity values, both the bookshelf have same capacity values of 100 of 10 books, but here now you are only using half of it. 2, you are using half of it. So 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Five sections are there, but this area, what about this? This is totally empty. Correct or not?
Correct.
Same thing is applies here. So only the 5, 1, 2, 3, 4. So 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, but this is again empty. That is your internal fragmentation. Got it?
Got it.
Now we do have the external fragmentation, which relates to where the new bookcase would be physically allocated. It would probably need to be placed at the end of the library, even would logically need to be in a different order. This means if I want to read the bookcases in order, I no longer just walk directly from one bookcase to another. Instead, I would need to follow pointers around the library to track a chain between books. So now, for example, this slot was there and I have put my next book into the this slot. So I know that my new available book is on the last slot. So external fragmentation relates to where the new bookcase would be now. If it is in the last, don't you think it's easy for me to grab it or to capture it? Because now I know that new book is there, which is in the sixth shelf. Correct?
Correct.
But if I did something like this, I have placed this book here. And the book which was there, I have placed it here.
So it's then in two places now?
The book which was there on shelf number 3 is now on shelf number 6. Maybe some update statement or update operation work, and then they have just, you know, misplaced each other.
Mm-hmm.
Getting my
point? Mm-hmm.
So now this was the new book, actually.
Okay.
This was the old book. Now what I need to do, it will be a problem then. Why? Because it is in the middle. Then I may need to check for the middle, and then I need to scan thoroughly, and I need to track a chain between the bookcases. Then only I will be able to get that book. That's basically the external fragmentation, where the sequence is totally disrupted. Here everything was fine, but only the empty space was there, which was the issue. Here everything was fine, a new book was there, but that book has been replaced. So now the book which was already there, it is put it to the new shelf, and the one which one was the old one, that actually put it, or we generally put it into the wrong shelf there. And that's where this concept is going to be applied of external fragmentation. This is what we call the external. Is it clear or not?
Yes.
And this one is the internal. If you still have any questions, any doubts, please ask.
No, that's fine. Thank you.
Okay. So now let's do one thing. Let's see a demo here. And in this demo, we will be talking about identifying the fragmented indexes and view the fragmentation of an index in SSMS. So first of all, but before that, you should also know that how to create an index as well.